Have you ever wondered how cartridges work in game systems and what happens when you plug in a cartridge into a system and power it on? At a high level, the data that's stored on the ROM chips is applied to the hardware's memory map location for the ROM and allows for the game to run. But let's take a closer look at how it works on my favorite handheld system, the Nintendo Game Boy. Released in 1989, the design of the Game Boy was simple yet technically brilliant. The graphics were just limited to four colors. Audio seemed simplistic, but in the right hands was capable of some truly amazing work. The screen was tiny, at just 160 by 144 pixels in size. Yet developers were able to extract some stunning effects from the graphical processing unit alone. With some fresh batteries, the Game Boy could last up to about 30 hours. And the games themselves were designed with handheld in mind. Nintendo built the Game Boy to be portable and not worry too much about bleeding-edge specifications. The system was powered by a custom Z80-based processor, which had been around for many years and was considered outdated, yet it was low power and versatile enough as a great fit for a portable gaming handheld. But perhaps the biggest feature would be its interchangeable cartridges. We don't even give it a second thought these days, but the Nintendo Game Boy would be one of the earliest handheld systems that featured a cartridge slot for interchangeable gaming. Yet, interchangeable cartridges would come with some challenges. As we said earlier, the Game Boy runs a custom Z80 processor by Sharp known as the LR35902 that's clocked at around 4 MHz. This is an 8-bit data processor, but also has a 16-bit address bus. But how can an 8-bit processor have access to a 16-bit address bus if it's only 8 bits? Well, it does this a number of ways. The program counter of the processor is 16 bits wide, which means if you use a calculator and type out 16 ones in binary representation, the processor can access addresses from 0 to hexadecimal FFFF, or in other words, 64 kilobytes of address space. The LR35902 has 8-bit registers, however, they can be also used in pairs of 16-bit operations. Data can be loaded and stored 16 bits at a time, and there's also the ability to perform 16-bit arithmetic. If we look closer at the Game Boy's memory map, we can indeed confirm that it's only 64 kilobytes in size, as this is the limitation of 16-bit addressing that we saw earlier. Of that 64 kilobytes, the lower 32 kilobytes is reserved as ROM space. Both the Game Boy and Game Boy Color share the same 64 kilobyte address limitations, and also share the same addressing model for ROM banking.
The Nintendo Game Boy can only utilize 64 kilobytes of address space, and 32 kilobytes of that 64 is composed of the ROM itself. So when you put a game into the Nintendo Game Boy, it allows you to only access up to 32 kilobytes of that internal ROM.
It is worth mentioning that the first 255 bytes are reserve space and the cartridge header is read at address hexadecimal 100. What this means is if we take a look at the ROM dump of Tetris in a hex editor and compare it to when we load the ROM in an emulator, we can see the exact header information at hexadecimal address 100. And this, for all intents and purposes, is where the program counter begins executing the game code. The Game Boy launched with 6 launch titles, including Tetris, Tennis, and Super Mario Land. And if we take a look at each of these games, they are all less than 32 kilobytes in size, and they will neatly fit into the 32 kilobytes of ROM space inside the Game Boy's memory map. But soon after launch, many games were released that were much larger than 32 kilobytes in size.
So the question is, how do these larger Game Boy games actually run on the Game Boy hardware when it's so limited in the amount of ROM space it can utilize?
The 32 kilobytes of ROM space is divided into two 16 kilobyte segments known as banks, Bank 0 and Bank X. Bank 0 is static, which means that this will never change, and will usually contain things for the game like the main game loop code, information about the game, metadata, its progress, high scores, and more. The upper 16 kilobytes of ROM space is known as Bank X. The Game Boy uses a technique known as bank switching. What this means is that a bank of code could be swapped into Bank X as it's needed. This is why you can't just remove a game cartridge from the system while it's playing. It's always accessing the cartridge and identifying and swapping in new banks.
Now, I want to be clear that bank switching is not something that is only available on the Nintendo Game Boy. In fact, many or most cartridge-based consoles used a similar bank switching methodology.
Nintendo knew that games larger than 32 kilobytes in size would soon become a standard, so they came up with a simple method to handle it. Known as MBC, or Memory Bank Controller, this was a chip that was installed with the game as part of the PCB. This chip would manage the bank switching. The programmer did not need to write their own controller code for the bank switching. That would be handled by the chip itself. But of course, they were still responsible for when it needed to let the MBC chip know what bank it needed to access at any given time. So how does the MBC chip work? There are different variations of the chip, but they all perform the same thing. The 16 kilobyte region known as Bank 1 or Bank X can point to different region banks located on the cartridge as needed, essentially allowing the Game Boy to overcome its 64 kilobyte addressing limitations. A simple 1-byte register could then be used to control which bank number should be accessed. In theory, a 1-byte register could allow for up to 255 banks. However, on the Game Boy, one of the controller chips known as the MBC5 allowed bank numbers for up to 9 bits in size, or up to 511 banks in total. If we do some simple math, 511 times 16 kilobytes means a theoretical limit of an 8 megabyte ROM, which is 128 times larger than the Game Boy's entire address space. And there is actually an 8 megabyte Game Boy Color cartridge that exists, Densha Digo 2, that has even eclipsed the Super NES, which largest commercial release is Tales of Phantasia at 6 megabytes.
And thanks to these sophisticated MBC controller chips, it was now possible to utilize many different tricks to do bank switching very, very fast and be able to get some really interesting effects out of the Game Boy itself, notably full motion video in some games such as Cannon Fodder.
Cannon Fodder has a very impressive full motion video introduction that runs for about 20 seconds. And if we run the game via emulation and take a look at the IO and registers, you can quickly see how the banks are being switched in order to stream the entire FMV sequence. But it wasn't just ROM space, it was even possible to expand the Game Boy's RAM size. With the MBC5 controller, you could add up to an additional 128 kilobytes of RAM to the Game Boy, which is many times larger than the amount of RAM on the system. The MBC1 controller chip, which was used in around 80% of all Game Boy and Game Boy Color games, had a maximum of 125 ROM banks and 32 kilobytes of RAM that could be enabled. Much of the time, the onboard RAM would be used to save the contents of battery saves to the game, such as Pokemon or Zelda Link's Awakening, which would open up additional RAM for save storage, provided that the battery wouldn't die on you, of course. So how does the Game Boy system know when a game is plugged in and there is an MBC chip installed? It's quite simple. There is code on every Game Boy game that has header information that lets the system know more about the game. If we look at hexadecimal address 147, this contains the cartridge type. A 0 means that it's ROM only. A hexadecimal value of 1 would represent the MBC1 controller chip that was being used with the cartridge. And as you can see, there are many different variations of possibilities here. Hexadecimal address 148 specifies the ROM size or the number of banks available. So for example, if 148 contains 04, it means that 512 kilobytes or 32 banks are available on the cartridge. Hexadecimal address 149 specifies the size of the external RAM, if there's any available. When the system knows that an MBC chip is installed thanks to the header information, it will then set up the chip to allow the controller flow of bank ROM and RAM information back from the cartridge to the system. The game itself will specify what bank number it needs to access and when. Going back to Cannon Fodder's example, you can see that the bank numbers are increasing inside the FMV sequence. This was all set up by the game's developer. Bank switching, while not exclusive to the Game Boy, made it possible for the handheld, with the limitations of just 64 kilobytes of address space, to run games many times larger than the size of the available ROM space, and the combination of interesting and unique graphical and audio effects meant that the limits of the system were pushed far beyond anything that was ever imagined. And this is yet another reason why I believe that the Game Boy is the most innovative and amazing handheld that was ever invented.
So there you have it, guys. That is how cartridges work on the Nintendo Game Boy, and how bank switching meant that you could run games that were a magnitude times larger than the ROM space, the kind of limited ROM space that you had available on the hardware itself. And it's a credit to Nintendo for coming up with such a simple yet elegant design for switching banks with the MBC chips that were found in many of the games themselves. Now guys, I'm going to leave it here for this video. Thank you so much for watching. If you liked it, leave me a thumbs up, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Bye for now.